And joining us now to talk more about the significance of this event is History Professor Shao Chua. Professor Chua, good morning. Welcome back to the program.
Makasaysayang umaga, Mike and Nikki, and to all our viewers.
All right, so Professor Chua, today we're actually commemorating Araw ng Kagitingan, or the Day of Valor, to signify the day 76,000 Filipino and American soldiers surrendered to Japanese troops in 1942. Now, not everyone may be aware of it now, but remind us, how significant was this event during that time, Professor Chua?
Well, first of all, it is significant because, number one, the Filipinos were the very last one to surrender to the Japanese during World War II in Southeast Asia. So remember that when Douglas MacArthur learned about the Pearl Harbor bombing, he was still preparing our ROTC cadets for war, and he will only fully prepare us by April of 1942. But December came and we already fought, and he concentrated all the forces because we cannot fight. The Japanese, they were so the Japanese Imperial forces were so big. They focused us on the defense of Manila, so Bataan. So all the USAFE forces went to Bataan, and for 3 months, January, February, March, April, for 3 months, we were able to drive away the Japanese and frustrate their plans of putting all their ship armaments to Manila because we were guarding Bataan. Although they were already in many parts of the country, including Manila, their invasion was not full. So we were able to show our valor despite all the odds, and the Americans were supposed to deploy food supplies and medicine to us. They weren't able to do it. And so they deployed it to Europe, and we were left on our own, you know, defenses, and we started dying, and that's why we have to surrender. First, of course, Mount Samat, a few days before Mount Samat, where the Dambana ng Kagitingan is now, and then eventually, that is the eye of the defenders of Bataan against the Japanese. But when that fell, eventually, of course, all the defenders will fall by April 9. And after that, of course, was the fateful death march, 100 kilometers. But because this event was so important, because we became the inspiration of the world. We were the last to fall in Southeast Asia. That's why they were calling, they had slogans before to get the people support the war effort in the United States. Remember Bataan.
So in a way, it was like Bataan was the last stand, not just for Filipinos, but even Southeast Asians against the Japanese Imperial Forces at that time. Professor Chua, talk to us about the death toll of that death march. Some are saying there are about 20,000 people who died, because out of the 76,000 who actually marched, only 54,000 survived. But are we able to actually determine how many died in that death march?
Well, we cannot be too concise about it. They're really just estimates, because we really do not know what happened to those who were. Some of course fell. We were not able to identify those who fell. For example, along the road, we do not know if they were properly buried, for example, or properly accounted for. Some were able to escape, and we do not know what happened to them. So yeah, we're not so sure about the numbers, but these are fair estimates because of the number of people who surrendered, and then the number of people who reach Camp O'Donnell. That is our indicator there.
But were there also stories of people surviving, those who fell on the wayside, but some Filipinos helping them survive that death march?
There was one story. This is only one of the stories, okay? By Dean Gloria Santos, wherein she was saying that some of the women who have big palda, they were letting some soldiers in, or at least one soldier in per every time, so that they can get away from the Japanese when no one was looking. And of course, at the great risk of people, of civilians. That's why when we talk about the valor in Bataan, it was not only the soldiers. It was also the civilians who were supporting them. In Angeles, Pampanga, for example, you know, the marchers were a place in a train from San Fernando, Pampanga to Capas, Tarlac. These trains are really, they were all canned like sardines in the boxes. And what happened was in Angeles, when the train passed in Angeles, Pampanga, people were throwing food, bread, whatever they can, so that they can help the marchers to survive. So and what happened was when they were already in Campo Donel in Capas, Tarlac, in which will be the commemoration tomorrow by the Philippine Veterans Affairs Office, people will feel that the heat of the sun while they were marching was even better than the conditions inside the camp, and they started to die inside the camp. That is because of the various diseases, because they were still camped there, cramped in a room of over 100 people. 200 people would be cramped inside.
And let's talk about the treatment of these soldiers at the hands of the Japanese. At that time, Professor Chua, there was no Geneva Convention yet on international humanitarian law that regulates the conduct of armed conflict. But from what you know, based on accounts, based on what we've read, would the treatment of the soldiers have been considered violations of the international humanitarian law? And what efforts have we exerted to actually demand compensation for it?
Well, from what I understand at that time, there was already something which was a protocol for war in countries at that time. For example, if you need sanctuary, you go to the church and no one should kill you. And the Japanese were still killing people inside the church. They did not have a concept of human rights at that time when they were. When we were under them, no? So for example, this is television. We cannot really describe all the horrors, but they were using all kinds of things like their katanas, for example, or even their bayonets in hurting people. And sometimes they even mock the people and laugh at them while they were dying. So these are the hardships that our soldiers felt. And there was one big group of surrenderees who were not placed in with the marchers. They were killed, summarily executed, one group of people, and that's why that is also one atrocious crime during the fall of Bataan.
And now we're hearing, we just reported that those who survived World War II are going to receive 20,000 pesos as pension. Is it ever going to be enough to actually compensate for what they went through during World War II?
No, nothing will compensate because it's really not about money. As far as I've heard from the PVAW, I last talked to them last month. In 2010, when I asked them, there were about 11 to 12,000 World War II veterans. That was a few years ago, 13 years ago. Now there were less than 500, perhaps less than 400 World War II veterans living. So there will be very few people. PVAW, of course, did its level best to compensate these people. But of course, with the Japanese, the problem was. The Americans actually told us to not get compensation from them, encouraged us not to get compensation from them after the war, because they were also recovering from the war. And Kirino, for example, pardoned all the Japanese soldiers in his humanity and brought them back home. So and that means that and even today we're finding difficulty getting compensation for comfort women victims, for example.
And Professor Chua, those watching us right now might be asking, of all the days in our Philippine history, why choose to highlight this day, supposedly the fall of Bataan, the last stand, over all the other days that we could probably celebrate or commemorate?
I would have preferred, for example, September 3 or September 2, which was the surrender of Yamashita. To become our commemoration of the war, because it highlights the victory of the Filipino guerrillas to get rid of the Japanese in all those 3 years of war. But I like in a way the highlighting of Bataan, because in many ways it tells us that Filipinos, there's something dramatic to it. That Filipinos will against all odds, against bigger forces, will have this valor, will still fight despite all the odds, and despite all the difficulties, despite being alone, for example. So we are resilient people, and it highlights this this event. Also, let me tell you that all of Bataan happened at around Easter. And so it was not lost to those who broadcasted. You are broadcasters. To those who broadcasted the fall of Bataan, that they reminded people that Jesus Christ died on a Good Friday. But don't worry, even if we lose now, there will be victory in the future, because the resurrection came eventually to Christ. And so it will be for the nation.
So there was a bit of a religious undertone during what happened. But Professor Chua, talk to us about the significance of the name of the event, because originally this was called Bataan Day. It was changed to Araw ng Kagitingan. Any significance to the change in name?
Oh, definitely, because when you say Fall of Bataan, it highlights that we were losers during the war. We were losers. And that is not a very good thing, because remember that after the Fall of Bataan was not the end of the story. There would be many other battles eventually that will win us the war, right? Like Kiangan, for example. And so eventually what happened was they realized that, yes, the fall of Bataan is important, but instead of highlighting the fall, we highlight the valor of the Filipinos. And we were helping the PIVAW, for example, as members of the Philippine Historical Association, to drum up the message that, yes, we commemorate Araw ng Kagitingan to highlight the Kagitingan, but not also the Kagitingan, but the valor, but also the victory of our guerrillas during the war. Because it was not, we always highlight the Americans, MacArthur helping us, but yes, they helped us. But it was us who did the job on the ground with their help, but also with the guerrilla forces. And so we also highlight that we Filipinos won the war every time we commemorate the Araw ng Kagitingan on April 9.
And Professor Chua, talk about the day of observance, of commemoration of this event. What do you make of the practice of moving holidays due to the so-called holiday economics? Well, to be fair, this happened during that time of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. It's happening now under the Marcos administration. Does it in any way detract from commemorating the actual event when we move it to another day?
Well, first of all, Let us emphasize that the holiday economics was junked after President Arroyo, because eventually a lot of the businessmen felt that this, it's not very good, because the businessmen do not like, you know, you already have a holiday on a Sunday, and why don't you put it on a Monday? It'd be double pay, right? But whatever it is, I'm not really a fan of moving holidays, and especially commemorations. They said that they will just move the holiday, but not the commemorations. They clarified it before, but now they moved even the commemoration, and they have a good excuse because of Easter Sunday. Perhaps they wanted more, the president wanted to have a little more time for himself on Easter Sunday and say, it's Easter Sunday, come on, let's move it. Because I've heard that the first, I've heard from some of the officials last month that April 9 will push through, but last week I was told it would be April 10. So I'm not a fan of it, but I guess they have a good excuse to, because it's Easter Sunday, they do not want to detract people from commemorating the resurrection of the Lord. And so we are now, we are able to move this commemoration on this day, April 10, which is still, of course, part of the Death March anniversary, for example. But and the Philippine Veterans Week, because we're commemorating what we call the Philippine Veterans Week. But I hope that this will not happen to other commemorations like Rizal Day, Independence Day, Bonifacio Day, for example, because I think it would be counterproductive. They can move the holiday, but I hope that they can still commemorate on the important milestones of our nation.
And Professor Chua, President Marcos is expected to speak later at 8 in the morning at an event in Mount Samat, Bataan. What do you expect him to say? And his very presence in that event, in Mount Samat no less, what does that tell you?
Well, in a way, first of all, despite the fact that Marcos, Ferdinand Marcos Sr., the son, the father, I mean, exaggerated his claims as a war hero, he was a defender of Bataan. Okay, mm-hmm. We should give him that. And it should be very close to President Bongbong Marcos, because Bongbong Marcos' father, Ferdinand Sr., was the one who made this monument in Mount Samat, a very important mountain that also fell with Bataan during the fall of Bataan. I mean, it was captured by the Japanese. And so to put the memorial there and to be, you know, to return there as president when his father used to lead the commemorations there, should have been, I don't know if he will emphasize it, but he would probably emphasize it in his speech. Of course, he will drum up the theme that in order to face the odds, we must begin real unity in this country as the theme of his presidency. But hopefully, of course, that unity would entail that he would also, or he and his people, his forces, would also be more, shall we say, diplomatic, as they were trying, at least, diplomatic towards other forces in the country that might not agree with them.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for another educational and insightful discussion, Professor Xiao Chua.
Thank you very much. Mabuhay ang kagitingan ng Pilipino.